everyone. My name is Surabhi and I work as a school safety specialist at Seeds India. Today, we are going to discuss about understanding disasters. So what is a disaster? Or when the word strikes to us, what do we understand? Or what kind of picture comes to our mind? It is generally about destruction, loss of life, property damages, houses broken, blood flowing around, and so on. But disasters are also often regarded as an unusual event, not part of our normal lives. In reality, however, it is not so true. Disasters and emergencies are a fundamental part of our normal life. They are consequences of the way societies structure themselves socially as well as economically. Disasters do not occur every time a community is exposed to a drought, fire, or a conflict. Say for example, a drought has occurred this year in Marathwada. It may or may not occur in the same village or in the same region next year. So that is what we understand by it not occurring again and again in the same community. What is a disaster? In definition, according to Charles Kelly, a disaster is an event which gives rise to casualties, loss of property, damage to infrastructure, essential services, and means of livelihood on a scale which a community cannot cope on its own. Disaster also ruins years of investment, but at the same time, it places new demands for reconstruction and rehabilitation. As you can see in this image, it's an image from Kashmir floods 2014, a village in Pulwama district. This image can rightly tell us what Charles Kelly was trying to tell in the definition. Here, the house has been completely ruined and it took the family to construct a house of this size 10 years. But for the flood, it just took a day to destroy it to ruins. Charles Kelly in his definition also talks about essential services being damaged. What is it that we mean by essential services? The first thing that strikes through our mind is the services without which we cannot live. It can be health, law and order, means of communication, transportation, and so on. When we say health services being affected, it can be that a hospital or the nearest health facility is being damaged or completely destroyed. It can also mean that in the impacted area, or let's say the affected area, it's the only hospital that has survived but cannot accommodate hundreds and thousands of patients or injured parties. Means of communication, which means that our means to communicate with our loved ones or dear ones is disrupted. Telephone, on which our entire world is very much dependent today, is the first to get damaged and affected during an event. Fourth is transportation. Roads being damaged or dismantled, public transport is the first to go out of service. These are few of the essential services. Apart from these services, there are few basic necessities which also get affected during a disaster. It is access to food and safe and clean water supplies, electricity, safe shelter, which are also compromised. Charles Kelly also talks about livelihood being impacted. When we say livelihood, the first thing that comes to us is economic losses that we as an individual or as a state face, but that gets sidelined during such events, which are the daily wage earners, who not only lose their only resource of earning, but also the source of their survival. So why do disasters occur? Generally, if in a impacted area, if we go and talk to the locals and ask, why do you think it has happened here? Mostly the answers come as, that it is because of the past sins that the state has been facing. Or, for example, too much of violence has occurred. Or it is just our misfortune, or for that matter, karma. For example, during Uttarakhand floods, the locals believed that they were punished with flash floods because a temple was being relocated as a nearby dam was being constructed. Same goes for Kashmir Valley, where people thought that the valley has been corrupted to such a great extent that it needed some cleansing. In reality, or scientifically speaking, these disasters generally occur due to climate change and exploitation of natural resources. Massive deforestation for creation of highways and tunnels, adoption of uniformity in construction and development practices, misuse of water bodies and nearby land, these all lead to disasters. So now, as we have gathered an understanding on what is disaster, let's now try to understand the related terms with disaster. Some of them are hazard, vulnerability, and risk. When we talk about hazard, it is a natural phenomena and also a human-induced phenomena, which may cause physical damage, economic loss, and threaten human life, for example, living in a hill, a drought, or a conflict for that matter. Such phenomena may affect different places differently. It can affect individually or it can affect in a combination. According to IFRC, a threatening event or a probability of occurrence of a potential damaging phenomena within a given time or period is called a hazard. Now, moving to vulnerability. Vulnerability is most often associated with poverty, but it is not so. Vulnerability is a term that is used to describe the exposure to hazards and shocks. People are more vulnerable if they are more likely to be badly affected by an event outside their control. Now, risk. It's a very generally used term among all of us. We generally say that let's not take that risk, or it's too risky, let's not do that. Risk is also when we secure our Facebook accounts and Gmail accounts with the strongest passwords so that nobody can hack it. Terminologically speaking, risk is an expected damage or loss due to the combination of vulnerability and hazard. People are considered at risk when they are unable to cope with a disaster. For example, constructing a house at a mountain cliff or say near an ocean. Although it's a very beautiful and a romantic idea, but here we sideline and also never think about the risk that it can either be caught into a landslide or can get submerged due to a tsunami or a flood. Moving on to capacity. The word itself means an individual, group, or local communities that can cope or has the potential of coping with a disaster. It also refers to the survival skills, resources, and strengths that can be used or can be utilized to help themselves and others. Practical strategies to organize themselves to cope with a disaster. In coping capacities are well developed, the vulnerability is less and the risk of disaster is reduced. Let me share a case study here with you. During Uttarakhand floods, I met an 8-year-old boy. He was a survivor. He had seen the Kedarnath floods very closely. In fact, the day when it all happened, he had gone to the temple with his grandfather. When the dam broke loose and the water came in the valley, he described it as a hungry, huge black cloud with a giant mouth that is coming to eat me. He somehow, along with his grandfather, managed to escape the water course and ran towards higher mountains and into the jungle. On his way, he picked up few packets of biscuits and tubes of toothpaste. For 7 days, he and his grandfather survived with just few toothpastes and few packets of biscuits before they found help and were returned safely to home. So our survival skill, strength to deal with such catastrophe, can help us overcome or as well as reduce potential risks. So why is it important to understand disasters or its impact? As we all know, India has seen many disasters in past years. Some of the major disasters that our country has witnessed are Gujarat earthquake of 2001, Indian Ocean tsunami 2004, Uttarakhand flash floods of 2014, to the recent Kerala floods of 2018. Although after every disaster, development takes place, but not necessarily on the lines of the lifestyle and culture of the area. For example, let's take this image. It is from a village rehabilitated post the Latur earthquake of 1993. In this image, we can clearly see a concrete constructed house. It was constructed according to a family's income, because after the Latur earthquake, the rehabilitation criteria was completely based on the income that the family earns as well as the land holding of the particular family. In a typical Indian context, when we say village, the first thing that strikes us is a joint family. And same was the case with Latur. The families lived together and it accommodated minimum 10 people to maximum 25 people within a family. So practically speaking, and as you can see, this particular house cannot hold 10 to 25 people in itself, as it is just a one room kitchen house. So over the years, although it is a earthquake resilient house, people in the villages have made makeshift rooms attached to the shelter. In the next image, as you can see, there is a tin shed just outside the house. Although the efforts have been made by government to reduce the destruction or damage to property as well as human lives, such makeshift shelters or increasing the surrounding of the shelter would only lead to more destructions, as it is the only way to come out of the house. As you can see, it is the front side of the shelter. So why do such issues arise? Is it because of lack of preparedness, or is it because we lack the awareness about such destructions, or is it both? To my understanding, it is a combination of both, because when the Latur earthquake happened in 1993, civilians as well as the administrative departments had never imagined that such high-level catastrophe would strike, and at such magnitude it would strike the region. Taking another example of Kumbakonam fire, we are all aware that the Kumbakonam fire in Tamil Nadu took place in a school which had thatched roof and it caught fire. Nobody ever thought that it could turn into such a massive disaster, killing 94 children in it. We never think that our town, our homes, our institutions where we go to learn or to do a job can ever face such massive destruction, and hence we never prepare to face losses. We only think of developing and progressing. Or if a tragedy occurs, can the building or area access resources, be it a fire brigade or an ambulance? Going back to the Kumbakonam example, in Kumbakonam fire, another major reason why it led to the whole building's catching fire was because the fire brigade could not pass through the narrow lanes. Taking an example again from our day-to-day lives, even in our homes, we never have a fire extinguisher because we never think that a home that we have built with so much of love, care and affection can also face a tragedy or an accident. But if it does, and when it does, we should also think about how the losses can be reduced. So hence, in today's world, it is very much essential to establish a culture of safety. Now that we have gathered an understanding on disaster and why it is essential to know what a disaster is, let's move to the types of disaster. In general, there are two types of disaster. One is natural and another is human-induced events. Natural hazards can be listed as earthquake, flood, volcanic eruptions, cyclone, tsunami, etc. Whereas human-induced events can be terrorist attacks, fire, conflicts, riots, chemical, transport, industrial accidents. The biggest example of such an industrial disaster is of Bhopal gas tragedy. The third type that has emerged in recent years is termed as silent disasters. Silent disasters are events that are faced in our day-to-day life and can get aggravated during an occurrence of a hazard. These events can range from water, hygiene, sanitation, to road accident, abuse, cybercrimes, bullying, kidnapping, etc. When we talk about events like these, we mostly refer to the availability of resources, access to resources, and creating a safe environment. For example, a drought. If we manage water and inculcate a culture of preservation and stop or reduce exploitation of water resources, we can minimize the effect of it from becoming a disaster. Excessive interference with environment has resulted into extreme climatic change like dust storm and urban flooding, which has emerged as new climatic events. Urban flooding has also been witnessed in past few years, be it in Chennai, Kashmir, or Kerala. So, now that we have understood the types and disaster, what is that we as an educationist can do about it? Or how can we contribute towards it? Being an educationist, if we understand the hazard, risk and vulnerability and increase our awareness as well as preparedness, we would understand a disaster a better way and we can save precious lives and resources. For further details, please refer to the reading material. Let's together inculcate a culture of safety. Thank you.